Už poskusil, če tvoj mikrofon dela. Dela? Ja, hvala, mislim, bolj dela. A hvala za Božo Stavec, hvala za podporo. Božo, kjer?
Dobar dan, vsem skupaj, jaz bi vas tudi pozdravil, vse, ki ste se udeležili. Nažalost, upali smo, ker nas bo dosti več, vendar v zadnjem času smo bili priča kar velike medijski gonji proti konoplji. Vsi časopisi so bili polni tega, zato je verjetno tudi tole rezultat. Upam, da bo jutri večji obisk, ker je tudi dan odprtih vrat ljubljanskih lekarn, ki bodo mogoče celo ker iz druge strani prišli čest pogledati. To je četrti seminar iz cikla Demystifikacijo konoplje, nadaljujemo delo Uneja, s katerim smo še vedno trdno povezani. Namen seminarja je širjenje znanja na tem področju, ker nažalost je v Sloveniji gibalo, so postali tako imenovani aktivisti, povsod po svetu so pobudo prevzeli večinoma zdravniki. Pri nas je pa tega uradna stroka še vedno zelo otepa, ker tistega, kar ne poznaš, se pač bojiš in se ga probaš izogibati. Da konoplja ne bi bila zdravilna ali da bi imela kakšne strašne stranske učinke, ni res. Konoplja je najbolj raziskana rastlina na planetu, z objavljenimi več kot 115 tisoč znanstvenimi študijami o konoplji in učinkovinah, kar pomeni nekje 7 študij poprečno na dan. K organizaciji smo skušali privabiti seveda zdravniško zbornico, ministrstvo za zdravje, nacionalni inštitut, in vse ostale akteri, ki bi morali danes tu sedeti, pa nažalost ne, da bi se kaj o tem naučili. Vendar mislim, da so si sami krivi, ker pač sami gubijo kredibilnost na tem področju in skrajni čas je, da bi se začela tako imenovana stroka na tem področju tudi izobraževala. Jaz bi še izpostavil, pa bom kasneje povabil Dejana, da pride gor, stanje na področju tako imenovanih prepovedanih drog v Sloveniji, predvsem konoplje, je alarmantno. Tisti, ki so zadolženi za to področje v evropske inštitucije, pošiljajo prirejena poročila, manipulirajo z tako na ministrstvu za zdravje kot v parlamentu in v vladi, s tem, da podajajo neprave informacije. In v zadnjih dneh, ko se je začela ta gonja proti konoplji, je to bilo toliko bolj očitno. Lahko smo brali tudi v dnevnem časopisju. Hvala vam vsem, ki ste se udeležili. Ne glede, ko nas je malo, konoplja.net, Mirjan in ostali bodo vse tu skupaj posneli, ki bo pristalo na internetu, ker bo vsem pač brezplačno dostopno na našem kanalu. Povabil bi Dejana, namreč PEST, Društvo za človekove pravice, je del zveze nevladnih organizacij na področju drog. Skušamo stvari premakniti malo po drugačni poti in sicer po nekonvencionalni poti in probamo priti preko državnih uradnikov do državnih uradnikov oziroma politikov. Dejan je predsednik Zveze nevladnih organizacij z področja drog, predstavil se vam bo sam, pa tudi kar delamo. Hvala.
Hvala Božu. Lep pozdrav vsem skupaj tudi v imenu Zveze nevladnih organizacij za droge in njihovo uporabo. Zveza je krovna organizacija in na te naloga zveze je predvsem ureditev področje zakonodaje v Sloveniji. In sicer zakonodaje, ki bi bila v interesu najširše javnosti. Vseh državljank, vseh bolnikov, zaradi tega, ker si oni to zaslužijo, predvsem si pa to zaslužijo rastlina, konoplja. Članice zveze so odbor za konopljo, društva, klubi, ki pomagajo bolnicam in bolnikom. Mete sodi tudi organizator današnjega srečanja, kongresa, tega simpozija o demistifikaciji konoplji in renesansi konoplji, društvo PEST. Tisto, kar zveza nevladnih organizacij hoče doseči v Sloveniji, je popolna dekriminalizacija uporabe konoplje in legalizacija gojenja konoplje za lastne potrebe. To nam pripada po 28. členu enotne konvencije Združenih narodov o narkotikih in da temu ni tako, so zelo uspešno to skrivali pred javnostjo tudi na Ministrstvu za zdravje, kjer nikoli niso prevedli te konvencije. Glede na to, da se sa zakonodaja o drogah v Sloveniji, da sa zakonodaja o drogah temelji dejansko na te enotni konvenciji, mi pravzaprav živimo v pravnem vakumu. To poskušam dopovedati vsem birokratom, tudi tistim, ki ne razmišljajo toliko z glavo, ampak bolj z repom in pa z denarnico na Ministrstvo za zdravje in ne slišajo na toliko. Mogoče, da bi čisto informativno, ta teden smo imeli po dolgem času sestanek Komisije za droge Vlade Republike Slovenije in na tem sestanku je prišlo do nekaterih zame frapantnih odkritij, kako pravzaprav funkcionira celoten mehanizem in da je to ena majhna peščica ljudi, ki dejansko ima svoje interese. In zame je frapantno, da se kakšna komisija za preprečevanje korupcije ali pa nekdo ni lotil še teh ljudi, kar kaže na to, kako za njimi stoji farmacija in pa koruptivni politiki. Skratka, naloga zveze je urediti to področje, ampak to je vojna, ki jo dobivamo, ki jo bomo dobili in to je globalna vojna, to ni vojna samo Slovenije, ampak to je nekaj, kar se dogaja v svetovnem merilu. In to, da so laži v medijih in v političnih krogih se bolj kritične kaže na to, da zgubljajo vojno. Najlepša hvala.
Morda bi vas čestil, da torej, cel državni aparat je treba nekako spraviti v zdravo pamet, ne? Kaj pa predsednik pravi o tem, ki je sponsor, častni pokrovitelj tega dogodka?
Hvala, jaz sem prej pozabil. Pa ne bi smel seveda, ne? Ampak zaprosili smo predsednika države, ki je že bil sponsor oziroma častni pokrovitelj dogodka. In sicer pravi tak, spoštovani gospod Radišič, zahvaljujem se za pismo, v katerem prosite za prevzem častnega pokroviteljstva nad seminarjem Renesansa konoplje. In sicer v ciklu demistifikacija konoplje, ki jo letos pripravljate že četrtič. Želeli bi vam sporočiti, da predsednik Republike z veseljem prevzema navedeno častno pokroviteljstvo in vam želi uspešen potek seminarja in vas prijazno pozdravljam. To je edini od politikov, pač nažalost, ki se je sploh odzval na to. Moram pa poudariti, da je bil predsednik Pahor že pokrovitelj prvega seminarja leta 2014 v Hotelu Unijo. Jaz bi zdaj prosil,
Dobro, torej na nek način, če jaz prav razumem, to ga malo promoviramo, predsednika, ampak vse ni problema, če bo za to kaj napravo. To je pri nas pravilo na Štajerskem. Torej, jaz sem v osnovi kulturni delavec, ukvarjam se tudi z organizacijo stand-up komedije, tako da ne se čuditi, če bom kako bolano vsekal. Včasih človek večinja pametnih besed, upam, da ste tudi sami to že dojeli. Tako, sem pa tudi kmet, ne? Bio dinamičen kmet, pridelujem konopljo, tako da tudi kakva kmečka lahko pride, zelo neugodno znam biti, seveda. Dobro, Božo, moram priznati, da si se zelo potrudil, cela ekipa, zopet ste pripeljali v Slovenijo, v Maribor, direktno pred oči možnost komunikacije strokovnjake. Nekateri med njimi so tukaj v živo, nekateri med njimi bodo preko interneta komunicirali. Izvolim.
Jaz bi se tudi še v imenu Lumirja in so vsisli upravičil, namreč nažalost bolezen nikoli ne počiva in so vsisli imela pred dobrimi tremi tedni težko operacijo. In je bilo prenevarno, da bi iz Arizone priletela, zato se nam bo kasneje pridružila preko interneta. In pa Lumír bi moral prileteti v Ljubljano v nedeljo zvečer, ker smo mu tudi organizirali vzpon na Triglav, vendar se njegovo ženo nažalost odpeljali v nedeljo večer na urgenco, ker je imela postopek na srcu, vstavljali žilne opornice in so še nekaj naredili na robe in je bilo tako nevarno, da je pač moral ostati doma. Vseba nam bo pa, kot ste že prej videli, itak pridružil tudi po Zoomu. Hitra aplikacija, tako bo lahko direktno odgovarjal tudi na vaše vprašanja, kar smo že tudi preizkusili. Samo toliko. Pa še vsem, ki pomagajo, seveda pri organizaciji, od prevajalk do 1000 ljudi, ki so nam pomagali, bi se rad lepo zahvalil. Hvala.
Mislim, da je trenutek, da še napovemo naše goste, da vse nam bo pomagal demistificirati konopljo in nekako jo spraviti na normalen skupni imenovalec. Torej, najprej bi prosil, če pozdravite z enim aplauzom doktorja Františka Bednarika, ki prihaja iz Češke. Tako za trenutek. František je agronom in raziskovalec, rojen v Zlinu. Jaz tudi prej nisem vedel, tako kot mnogi med vami, Zlin, po čem je znan, pa vsi smo bili v Zlinu, vsi smo mi že stali v enem koščku Zlina. Vemo tako, kdo o čem govorim, Bata Škorni nastaja, oziroma Bata Vutev nastaja v Zlinu, eno čudovito mesto, posebna arhitektura in iz tega mesta nam prihaja gospod, ki je raziskoval, oziroma izobražen kmetovalec, agronom, strokovnjak za gobe. Zanimivo, me zanima, katere gobe ima najrajši. Potem, seveda užitne, je raziskoval kaljenje gozdnih dreves, zelo zanimivo tudi vse zame, ki nekaj delam v gozdu. In pa na področju kmetijske tehnike in rasti konoplje nam bo kaj več povedal, predvsem pa je zanimivo tudi njegovo delovanje na področju veterine oziroma uporabe konopljenih produktov pri živalih. Tako da, jaz grem po vrsti ne tako, kot bodo predavali, tako, kot so bili sprintani na internetu oziroma z interneta. Tako, povzetek predavanja, pravzaprav je to čisto dovolj, kaj bo predaval. Naslednja gostja je dr. Doroti Ble. Doroti je tukaj, kjer se... Aha, in dajte se enda ples, in te na glas prosim, za Doroti, farmacevka, raziskovalka, ko sem bral o njej, kaj vse je počela, ljubi Bog tega, zdaj ne moram tukaj niti preleteti, kaj šele povedati, zelo referenčna. In pa, kaj bi morda za konec, pravzaprav njenega tega, kako smo temu rekli, izvleček Jezus Kristus, koliko listo je bilo vsega. Torej, kako napraviti klinično študijo, in kaj vse je treba upoštevati in kaj vse so oni počeli, kako so sploh prišli do vseh strokovnih študij in parametri, ki so jih iskali na koncu, če se ne motim, 45 študij iz vsega sveta vseh časov ustrezalo in kaj vse so prebrodili, da bi to danes funkcioniralo, nam bo gospa z prve roke povedala. Torej, z nami je še iz Španije dr. Guillermo Valesco Diez, Guillermo, kažu. Biolog iz tebe, biokemik, raziskovalec, prihaja iz Španije, z rakom se je ukvarjal veliko in nam bo tudi o tem največ povedal. Dr. Lumír Ondřej Hanuš, ki ga imamo na internetu, bo že razložil, zakaj in kako, je pa bil že velikokrat osebno v Sloveniji, in prijazen gospod, ki je vedno pripravljen v miru razjasniti človeku to, kar je težko razumeti. Govoril bom pa o drugih pomembnih spojinah, ki jih najdemo v konoplji oziroma v nekih ekstraktih ali kakorkoli v rastlini konoplja. Upam, da o terpenih tudi marsikaj zaenkrat vsi THC, CBD in še nekaj drugih kanabinoidov. Zadaj je ogromno spojin, ki so zelo pomembne in upam, da bomo tudi kaj o terpenih slišali. Morda en pozdrav, aplauz za Lumíra v Izraelu. Z nami je tudi dr. Paul Hornby, Biolog, biokemik, patolog, raziskovalec, človek, ki te lahko spremlja tudi, ko si živ. Mislim, tudi, ko si mrtev. Tako. Vidimo se na patologiji, ki nam bo marsikaj povedal dejansko o renesansi konoplje, če povzame njegovo predavanje na ta način, kaj vse se je dogajalo z njo in kam smo danes prišli, nekako iz enega širšega aspekta. Z nami je še en modr človek, dr. Robert Melamed. Zdravljam ti bez. Molekularni biolog, biokemik, raziskovalec, človek s številnimi titulami, nekako neprijetno bi mi bilo vse to naštet, ker ne znam vsega niti prebrati. Moram povedati tudi to, da konopljo danes nekako, ko raziskujemo, se srečujemo s tolkimi težkimi tujimi pojmi, bom rekel za nas lajke, ampak kjer volja, tam pot in nekako na tej poti nam bodo ti strokovnjaki pomagali, da bo to vse postalo še bolj prijazno za nas. Homeostazo nam bo nekako poskušal predstaviti, pravzaprav nam je poslal kar celo predavanje za povzetek, pa bom ga postil njemu, da bo ga predstavil. Z nami je tudi magister Dušan Noliman, zdravnik, specialist javnega zdravja, raziskovalec. Gospod Noliman, da se lahko sliši. Tudi njegovo predavanje bo za moje pojme silno zanimivo. Pravzaprav vidim, da se je zelo temeljito pripravil, ampak imam občutek, da bo šel po naravni inerciji, da bo povedal točno tisto, kar bo v tistem trenutku mislil, zato ga reši ne napoveduje vsebinsko. Tako, Božo, mislim, da smo vse...
Susisli.
Kje pa je susisli? Susisli je ostala kje? V Ameriki?
Ja.
In nekje pa mislil nazaj.
Jo imaš?
Ne, ne najde bilo.
Dobro, sad je lahko jaz. Susisli je psihijatrinja iz Tucsona v Arizoni, ki upravlja trenutno prvo klinično študijo za posttraumatski sindrom v Ameriki, ki je odobrena strani FDA in IDE. Vendar problem SU je, o čemer bo govorila ta, da enostavno uradno ne dobi zadosti kvalitetnega materijala, da bi lahko sploh študijo spravila skozi. To je pa ista zafrkancija birokratov, ker politiki dan danes niso proti spremembam na področju konoplje, ker politiki vedno hočejo biti všečni, ampak imajo iste probleme z FDA, z NIDO, z vsemi ostalimi, kot mi in z našimi birokrati v Sloveniji, nažalost. Susa nam bo kasneje priključila, 9 ur je tega zamika, verjetno bo malo kasneje kot druga, ker mi smo hoteli, da bo z nami do zadnjega trenutka, vendar se nam nažalost ni išlo. Tako, jaz bi zdaj kar prepustil, Slavko, ti boš kar Lumirjeno povedal, ali ga pa bo Lumir kar začel svoje predavanje.
Se je Lumirja sva dejansko žena povedala, pravzaprav se mi zdi, da je najboljše domače vzdušje, da nismo pretirano strogi, pa da se bova še odločila, kdaj bova tistega komala zvezanega pretepla. Mogoče takoj, mogoče vmes, mogoče na koncu, mogoče pa neče se 33.
Jaz bi samo še opozoril, prej je Slavko rekel o drugih spojinah v konoplji. Moramo povedati, da tudi druge rastline vsebujejo podobne komponente kot konopla in to so ponovadi rastline, ki so zelo dobri spodbajevalci imunskega sistema za hinacejo na čelo in tudi ostalimi. Tako ni so zdravilne spojine samo v konoplji, ampak so tudi v drugih rastlinah. Upam, da ne bodo slišali tega oni na ministrstvu za zdravje, ker bodo prepovedali vse to, tako kot so hoteli pred 10 leti prepovedati cimet, ker vsebuje kumarin. Recimo, ne. Hvala lepa. Lumír, can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear
you. Okay, can you share the screen, please, now, and you can start with your lecture.
Yes. Good morning. I'm really very glad that I can participate in this wonderful conference. Thank you very much to Božo Radišič, which the bridge between Jerusalem and Ljubljana, so I can be with you. Greetings to everybody in the hall. I see that in the first row there is Dr. Noriman, Hordi, Ednazig. In second row I see also my friend Melan, Robert Melamed. Greetings to everybody. Let me start my lecture. I am cannabis curative, just only cannabinoids, because at the present time anybody think that only THC and CBD are the most important compounds. But as I can show you, there are much more compounds, and I shall show you only several of them which have very important curative effects. So only a little bit from history, it will be very short. Cannabis, as you know, is very old cultural plant. Already in China, many thousand years ago, it was used as paper. From archaeological excavations, you can see nice shoe made from cannabis. And in Assyria, already, which more than thousand years ruled over this region, so was discovered their library on the clay tablets, and they had already at that time several names for cannabis, like Burburu, when it was used for ropes, Kurubu, when it was used in religious rites, Azala, it was something like a hand of gold. Probably it is what we can know today, like neurological diseases. And Gansigunu was translated like the rubber which screw up your mind. So it is what we can call today cannabinoids. So this is like this active compounds do. And only the third example, we several years ago had material from the Byzantine tomb from Judea, about 20 kilometers from Jerusalem in Bet Shemesh, and they found skeleton of a young lady, and she was pregnant and probably was supposed to give birth to a small child, and fetus was found also over there, and they found carbonized material, and we analyzed it, and we found that over there was delta 8 THC. When you see the structure, it's isomer of delta 9 THC, the most active compound. This compound is about 10 times less active, but it's very stable compound, and even after 1600 years still it was possible to identify it. I would like to go to the start or rebirth of medicinal cannabis, so I must return to Czechoslovakia, to Palacký University in Olomouc, where I did research with Professor Krejčí for 20 years. Professor Krejčí in 1950 discovered that cannabis is wonderful antibiotical principle when he studied higher plants. And he was, of course, curious what is the active compound, because extract had really significant effects on gram-positive microorganisms, including some pathogenic microorganisms, and it was studied in the hospital in Olomouc, also clinically in stomatology, otorhinolaryngology, gynecology, dermatology, and so on. And already in 1952, it was published in Medicinal Leaves, 1952, what you can see, and everything was, of course, in his dissertation from 1950. And in 1955, he published this Professor Shantavi publication, which found that the active compound is compound which they named cannabidiolic acid. In the fact, it was the first real compound from cannabis, because as we know, all compounds in cannabis are in the form of their acids, which decarboxylate later to appropriate compounds from cannabigallic acid to cannabidiol tetrahydrocannabinoid to tetrahydrocannabinol. Before this real, first real compound from cannabis was known only cannabinol, what is the composition product of THC. So already in 1954, in 10th December 1954, at the Palaski University in Olomouc was first scientific conference with name Konopia Kole, Cannabis as Medicine. And over there they presented results of clinical studies, and you can find it on this internet page, and everything is over there in English, so you can read all studies which they use in clinical studies in Olomouc. Of course, as I told you, these acids decarboxylate during ripening when there is resin on the flowers already is not a living material, so it starts to decompose with age, with sunshine, and it decomposes also after harvest and drying and during storage. Cannabidiol was a very important compound, and I would like to present you František Šantavý from Olomouc, Czechoslovakia. He studied cannabidiol, and also in Israel, Professor Yuval Shlo and Rafael Meshulam studied this compound, and they elucidated structure. In effect, first was Roger Adams, which suggested four structures, only he didn't know where is this double bond. So we suggested four structures, one of them was correct, but he didn't know which one. Professor František Šantavý in 1963 sent to publication paper which had not only correct structure of cannabidiol, but also what you see here, this is absolute configuration. Professor Shvo and Meshulam also published in 1963 paper where was correct structure of cannabidiol, but they didn't publish correct absolute configuration. This did only Professor Šantavý at that time. And also from the paper of Professor Meshulam, you can see there was no that Professor Šantavý informed us that he reached the same conclusions as we. So it happens often in science that on two places at the same time independently scientists reach the same result. Second compound which was studied was psychoactive compound responsible for these main effects of cannabis. It was delta 9 tetrahydrocannabinol, as you know, THC. And again, I must present František Šantavý from Olomouc, and from Israel, Yechiel Gaoni and Rafael Meshulam. And they studied again this compound. And this is correct structure, this correct absolute configuration. Again, Roger Adams in the United States in 1940s suggested this structure, but he didn't know where is the double bond. And he even didn't present any structure with this correct double bond. But František Šantavý, this paper which he sent to publication in 1963, appeared in 1964, this correct structure and correct absolute configuration. Yechiel Gaoni and Rafael Meshulam, they also published correct structure of THC, but absolute configuration was not correct. So again, Professor Šantavý correctly fully elucidated structure of THC. As I told you, cannabis compounds are their acids, and they start in the plant from cannabigerolic acid. And from this cannabigerolic acid are three independent ways to cannabidiolic acid, to tetrahydrocannabinolic acid, and to cannabichromatic acid. These three ways are independent ways, and there is no connection between them. So if somebody thinks that can be from cannabidiolic acid, tetrahydrocannabinolic acid, or from tetrahydrocannabinolic acid, cannabidiolic acid. Nothing like that. You can expensively prepare it in the laboratory, but not in the nature. And what is important, as I told you, active compounds which are used for treatment are decarboxylated compounds. So, for instance, if we have tetrahydrocannabinolic acid, it decarboxylates, it's loose CO2, and we have tetrahydrocannabinol. So, this is very important for treatment, but today we know that also acids are curative, and we can treat patients also with acids, only we don't have still enough knowledges to present some clinical studies. So it will be in the near future, but in Czechoslovakia, as I told you, from about 1955, we treated patients in hospital in Olomouc with cannabis extract. I prepared it from 1970 to 1990, before I left for 1 year to Israel. So 20 years I prepared it for drugstore, and they used it in hospital. It was not decarboxylated, it was based on the acids, mainly on cannabidiolic acid. And as soon as scientists had solved the structures of the main compounds, so they were interested how it works in organism. And in 1988, Dr. William DeWay at St. Louis University discovered cannabinoid receptor. He discovered CB1, which he called central cannabinoid receptor. He found it in the brain. It's this yellow one. And later was discovered also CB2 receptor, which is in immune system mostly. So this is almost the same structures, only CB1 receptor, as you can see, is longer structure. And as soon as was also cannabinoid receptor, so again, we were curious to know what is the compound natural in the brain, so-called ligand, which binds to these cannabinoid receptors. And again, I was lucky, it was in 1990, Professor Meshulam invited me after the fall of socialism in Czechoslovakia, and I met Dr. William DeWay, discoverer of cannabinoid receptors. He's specialist in molecular pharmacology, I'm specialist in analytical chemistry, so it was a very good combination. And after 1.5 years of hard work, we isolated this compound from the brain, which we named anandamide. It's, as you see, simple compound. It's derivative from arachidonic acid and ethanolamine, so arachidonic ethanolamide. And it binds to the receptors with the power 39 nanomoles. So it's wonderful, because we have receptors, we have molecule from plant, we have molecule from the brain, and from the higher plant and from the brain, these two molecules different bind to the same places in cannabinoid receptors with the same power. As I told you, this is 39 nanomoles, anandamide, and THC is about 40 nanomoles. So it's about the same power. Later, we were able to identify also other compounds like anandamide, gamma-linolyl-ethanolamide, docosapentaenol-ethanolamide, arachidonyl glycerol, and noladin. I succeed isolate these four, arachidonyl glycerol isolated chimorgan shaba. And then in United States, I isolated viridamine and naida. So we had these compounds, and as soon as was explained what is in plant, what is in brain, and how it works, so started everything what you can see today, that everybody is studying cannabis. 47 years ago when I started, so it was like, I was like curious person that worked with cannabis. Nobody was interested. Today, everybody wants to work on cannabis. What is, of course, good for patients. And I would like now compare what is the nature and what is pharmaceutical industry. I think that man cannot beat the nature. We can prepare, of course, more active compounds, but it's not such easy because synthetic compounds usually have side effects, what is disadvantage in comparison with cannabis. So what was prepared today and what was used for treatment, still we are in the start. As you can see, you can buy sativex for neuropathic pain, spasticity, patients with multiple sclerosis, but in the principle, it's from the plant isolated, so it is natural bound. So this is successful. And we have dronabinol, what is in effect? THC, tetrahydrocannabinol, which is of course used for patients which undergo treatment, chemotherapy, and they have nausea, vomiting, or patients with age, which has lack of appetite. So, and this is prepared, this THC, it works, but it's natural compound. And epidiolex, also, you know, this is highly purified extract of CBD. Again, it's from the plant. So, you know that CBD today is very useful to treat epilepsy. At children, and we already have many studies. Of course, first study with Professor Meshulam, this group in Brazil many years ago, maybe 30 years ago, but nobody took care. Only when they found it with this young lady with Dravet syndrome in the United States. So they started to be interested in this compound. And then we go to synthetic compounds. As you can, I apologize, there will be too many structures, but this is just to explain you power of cannabis. To treat nausea and vomiting was prepared derivative of cannabinoid. And instead of here is N-pentyl, so they prepare dimethyl heptyl, and here ketone group. So, useful compound nabilol, derivative of cannabinoid. And then was rimonabant. As you can see, rimonabant has no connection with cannabinoids. It's quite different structure, only it binds to cannabinoid receptors. And it was used as anti-obesity compound. But what was the problem? Many patients were in depression, and some of them even commit suicide. So they found at the end that this compound is not as suitable as they thought because it's anti-obesity compound, but side effects are really very dangerous. Another compound also, as you can see, structure has nothing with cannabinoids. Again, anti-obesity compound, but again, patients and I had like side effects, depression, anxiety, what didn't make this compound useful for treatment. Another compound is dexanabinol. This is again derivative, it's derivative of delta-8-THC, where methyl is hydroxylated, and instead pentyl is here a dimethylheptyl compound. And this compound is neuroprotective and is used after cardiac surgery, and it can be useful also to beat cancer. So still it's in progress to study this compound called adjuvenic acid. As you can see, again, derivative of delta-8-THC, instead methyl is here carboxy, instead pentyl is dimethylheptyl, and it's useful for multiple sclerosis patients. It can treat spasticity, it can be analgesic, anti-inflammatory, and it can be neuropathic pain also. And another compound is cannabinol. Cannabinol is very complicated compound. It's a little bit similar with cannabinoids, but has some side chains. And they use it like inflammatory compounds and for to treat hypertension. But again, side effects are like dry mouth, tiredness or dizziness, what is not serious, but still As you can see, if we compare with the nation, side effects are worse than cannabis. And HU308, this is compound which I accidentally found many years ago, that this binds to selectively to CB2 receptors. And this compound is also studied today, and it can be useful like anti-inflammatory, analgesic, treatment of hypertension, and maybe also useful in treatment of cancer. And the last one, which I show you, is derivative of THC, but as you can see, two keto groups here, and this is like for treatment, they thought that it could treat cancer. This compound was studied, but still I don't see that the results are useful, which can be used in medicine. So these are, what is better, nature or person? You can see that meantime nature means that cannabis and products of cannabis plant are more useful than these compounds. But as I told you, anybody is talking about CBD and THC. Of course, we have much more cannabinoids. Today are known 144 of them. But it was clear that these are not only cannabinoids, because it's known even from anecdotal cases, mostly because there still is lack of clinical studies, that if patients use a different strain of cannabis, where it's the same amount of CBD, THC, also ratio, one can treat this person, but not the other one strain. It means that there are in game also other compounds. And these compounds, Professor Meshulam called it entourage effect, that for instance, some inactive compound together with active compound make it more active. So what can be this compound? I suggest you only several of them, but there are many others which are active, and in the near future, probably from fall, I shall study just in a new lab in Jerusalem. So terpenes, mostly you can find in the plant monoterpenes and sesquiterpenes, and they have really wide range of biological and pharmacological activities. As you can see, they can be against cancer, anti-inflammatory, antimicrobial, parasitic, hyperglycemic, antioxidant, and so on. So we have monoterpenes. The main two of them is alpha-pinene and myrcene. Of course, myrcene, if it's in cannabis, so psychoactivity can be deeper. So this is not exactly what wants patient. Alpha-pinene is better. So we have different strains. I show you only three, but it can be monoterpenes. As you can see, here is the main myrcene, like monoterpene, about up to minute 15 are monoterpenes. After minute 15 to 25 are sesquiterpenes. So here is main myrcene, but can be also some other monoterpene. And sesquiterpenes, main of them is beta-caryophyllene, which was found that it's the only terpene which binds to CB2 receptors selectively. So it can be also very important compound. Or gamma element, also another sesquiterpene. And here you can see strain of cannabis, only terpenes I show, which has main terpenes, sesquiterpenes, and main of them is caryophyllene. And you have also strains, where are, which Dr. Horby called it like 50-50 strains concerning cannabinoids. We can call it also concerning terpenes and terpenoids. This is something like 50-50, that we have high monoterpenoids, high sesquiterpenoids. This is, here is like high myrcene and element and pinene and caryophyllene, like main compounds. If we look closely, to this compound, so what they can tell us. It's very good when it's alpha-pinene, like high terpene, because as you can see, it can be antibacterial, antiseptic, anti-inflammatory, bronchodilator. And beta-pinene, which follows this in the spectrum, and usually beta-pinene is less than alpha-pinene, also you can use it in asthma, and it's antiseptic compound. If we look on myrcene, which I told you that support THC in psychoactive effect, but also myrcene has of course positive, it depends on the amount which is in the plant. As you can see, it has antioxidant, analgesic, sedative, but what do you see? Anti-cancerogenic, anti-mutagenic compounds, and many others. All limonene, which is one of the main compounds, and just today appeared publication which tells that limonene is very important to beat some diseases. And as you can see, again, it's gastroprotective, anti-fungal, anxiolytic, antidepressant, antimicrobial, and so on. Or felandrene. Felandrene also, we have two felandrenes, alpha felandrene and beta felandrene, and they are very useful for digestive disorders, and they are antifungal. Then antifungal fungal is also ocimen, and for cardiovascular diseases can be very useful camphene. You must take in configuration all the time when it's very important what is the combination and ratio that certain this compound, these cannabinoids, can make this drug much more powerful in treating this treatment these diseases. And if you see another linalool and terpineol, this also are usually in cannabis. As you can see, linalool, antipsychotic, anxiolytic, anticonvulsant, antidepressant. So these are just compounds which make cannabis wonderful medicine. You see, antidepressant, and when we saw this synthetic, so this just are depressants. So this is just opposite side. And some others, antineoplastic, so again, it can influence patients with cancer. And terpineol, antibiotic, antioxidant, relaxing effect, very important, all these compounds. And when you see cariophyllene, I told you that this is the only compound which binds to cannabinoid receptor CB2. So again, cariophyllene, it was proved that it can be, it can treat cancer, and is analgesic, anti-inflammatory, antidepressant, and so on. And humulene is like alpha cariophyllene in the tech. Again, anti-tumor. So again, in treatment of cancer, also humulene can influence this treatment. And cariophyllene oxide, also anti-cancer compound, anti-inflammatory, antifungal. And this is the compound when you travel and they find, then you have cannabis, so dogs just find this compound, they smell this compound, cariophyllene oxide. They don't smell cannabinoids, they smell cariophyllene oxide, so this is very important compound also when they check you if you have cannabis with you. So if you bought, if you buy legal cariophyllene oxide and you work with cariophyllene oxide, you can have problems, even when you never saw in your life cannabis. And another group of compounds which are very important are polyphenols. Polyphenols have many very useful effects on our organism, like ellagic acid. Again, anti-cancer and antioxidant compound, as you can see. Not easy structure, but very useful can be. And then we have cumaric, caffeic, and ferulic acid. These acids, these are anti-diabetic, anti-hyperlipidemic, anti-cancer, also, again, you must understand that cancer doesn't breed only THC, that is combination of all these compounds and their correct proportion, because not every strain helps. Sometimes a patient must find correct strain and then it works. It's very important. And other polyphenols like protocatechic acid, hydroxybenzoic acid, rolic, vanillic. As you can see again, anti-cancer, vanillic, anti-cancer, gallic, anti-cancer, protocatechic acid, antioxidant, and they have many other effects like this acid, anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, antibacterial, and so on. So many effects. And chlorogenic acid, again, antifungal, anti-cancer, antioxidant, this is everything what was proved with these compounds, so, but we have lack of clinical studies, as I told you. And caffeoyltyramine, another polyphenol, which is natural antioxidant. As you know, antioxidants are very important for us, but of course this must be natural antioxidants, because exist also synthetic antioxidants, synthetic antioxidants, these are not good for your health, natural antioxidants, and also in certain concentrations, because too much antioxidants is not also good, because you know that the best compound if you take too much, so it's not healthful. And another is cannabis seed, just I wanted to show you different structures, so I took only some of them. It's natural antioxidant and again anti-cancer property of cannabis B. So you see that really chemistry and treatment that is not based just only one, two compounds from cannabis. And special part of polyphenols are flavonoid. This is like general structure of these flavonoids. And they have a wide range of biological and pharmacological activities. As you can see, they can be anti-cancer, anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, and many others, as you can read. And I would like to show you several of them to understand that it's complicated, all this chemistry. I show you only one. And this is chymferol. Chymferol, this is anti-cancer compound because modulates DNA methylation. What is the problem? When you have cancer, so there is decreased DNA methylation, and then you have many diseases because it's not properly established methylation. And as I told you, reduction of the DNA methylation has been demonstrated mostly in cancer. So these compounds which increase methylation are very important. And then we have flavonoid glycosides. Flavonoid glycosides, these are just flavonoids, but they are connected. These are structure, flavonoid plus sugar or several sugars. So these are antioxidant, antimicrobial, anti-inflammatory, and again, it can be anti-cancer compound. So I can show you several of them, like chymferol, glucoside, it's combination of chymferol and glucose, or diglucoside. This is against chymferol and two glucose together. And another is chymferol rutinoside. Again, herbis rutin, chymferol. And you can see sulforoside, just another sugar in combination with chymferol. As you can see, and I am talking only about chymferol, and we have much more flavonoids in the plant. And or chymferol rhamnoside, again, this another sugar, the same compound. So you must understand that it's very important that we have correct strain, but this must be studied to improve our treatment because we know, and also patients which treat themselves illegally, I don't call it illegal, it's legal, because each patient, if physician cannot help him, each patient has a right to treat himself or herself with the power of the nature. So it's 100% legal, but we call it like illegal, but it's not illegal. And from these informations, we know that what helps to one patient doesn't help to the other one. So we must find exact combinations and which strains are powerful for which patient. So this is strategy for the near future, and I hope that next time we can give you much more information, and not only to inform you, but that it can be useful also for patients. So at present time, as you can see, I studied 47 years, so I have all publications. So where I identified 1,269 compounds in cannabis. 144 are cannabinoid compounds. Usually we are talking about cannabidiol, tetrahydrocannabinol, cannabidivarol, tetrahydrocannabivarol, cannabinol, only several compounds, but there are much more active cannabinoids. And we have 1,125 other identified substances. Of course, there are some substances which will not be important, like vexes and hydrocarbons. But the compounds, as I mentioned, flavonoids and terpenoids, polyphenols, this can be very important compounds for treatment. So I hope that in the near future we shall have more knowledge, and that we shall have just a better approach to the treatment of different diseases and different patients. Thank you very much for your attention.
Hvala Lumiru za to predavanje, ostal bo z nami verjetno še naprej, bomo kasneje tudi lahko kaj skomunicirali. Naslednji, ki nam bo kaj več povedal o konoplji, molekularni biolog, biokemik in raziskovalec, dr. Robert Melamed, ali Bob, kot mu pravijo prijatelji. Dajmo še en aplavz za nas, da se malo trgli, kaj primaknimo.
Bob, can you have a slide here, and you will have a remote, yes?
The stand is good.
Okay, of course. Thank you.